Hello. A few months ago, I made a few videos about building an IDENT server using Async Await and Tokyo 0.2. I basically finished it, but at the end, I pointed out something that slightly sucks. If the client connects but never sends any data, the server will let it hold a connection open forever. The spec recommends that after a reasonable delay, like 1 minute, the server will stop waiting and just close the connection. As you will see, Tokyo is going to make this extremely easy. However, it's easy to miss just how impressive that is, and I want to take a minute to explain why. Timeouts are usually pretty annoying, but when you're programming with Rust futures, suddenly this hard problem goes away. The line of code that's bothering me is this one. We call await on it. We will not proceed until a line has been fully read or an error has occurred, such as the connection being closed. But imagine for a minute that this wasn't an async await program. Maybe we had a TCP stream from the standard library, and we're calling read on it. This is the exact equivalent in the blocking API. Either we get some data or an error occurs, and we have to wait forever for one of these two things to happen. If we're using a blocking function like this one, and we want a time limit, we're at the mercy of the library. As soon as we call this function, we've given up control. There's no general way in Rust to say, please call this, but force it to return an error if it takes more than 60 seconds. For that reason, blocking APIs will often give you some other way to set a time limit. For our imaginary TCP stream, we could use set read timeout to configure a duration, which is the maximum amount of time it will spend in any call to read. If I wrote my IDENT server using TCP stream, I would probably use this method to implement my timeout. Here's another example from the standard library. This is from the multi-producer single consumer channel, and we're looking at the receiving end. This receiver gives us a lot of choices. Try receive will return immediately if there's no data available. Receive will block forever. Receive timeout will let us specify a maximum duration. And if that amount of time elapses, it will return an error. We've just looked at two parts of the Rust standard library doing kind of the same thing. In both cases, we want to receive some data, but with a time limit. But the way we configured that was completely different in each case. Because there's no general solution to blocking timeouts, every library author has to come up with their own way to do it. So when I said timeouts are usually pretty annoying, this is what I'm talking about. And to be clear, I'm not criticizing the Rust developers for having two different timeout APIs. It's the operating system's fault, really. Now, let's go back to the async code. The beautiful thing about a Rust future, like this one that we're awaiting, is that we don't have the same restriction. We don't lose control of the execution. The Tokyo executor has to poll it over time until it reaches a final result. If we decide it's taking too long, all we have to do is stop polling it. And if we're no longer using the struct that implements future, just drop it. So, if futures are so amenable to timeouts, I should be able to fix this pretty easily, right? Yes, I can. All right, first I'm going to add a couple of new imports. All right, now I can wrap my future in a different future. For now, I'll just use 5 seconds because I can actually test that. So my inner future is now wrapped in an outer future returned by the timeout function, and we await on that instead. Let's try to compile that. Okay, it's going to fail, and the reason is that this timeout future has wrapped our answer in an extra layer of result because we could get a time elapsed error in the outermost result. So I'm going to add another unwrap here to get the OK result. And if it's a timeout, then we'll just go into the usual error case. Let's try that one. All right, that built. So if I run my server, I should be able to see this working. If I type a query within a couple of seconds, that works. If I wait for 5 seconds, it just drops the connection. Hooray, it works. Of course, that number should be 60 seconds, and the spec says I'm supposed to make it configurable, but you get the idea. We could stop there, but first I want to make things more difficult. When we create this timeout wrapper, what it's really doing is creating a second future, a delay, and racing it against the original future. If the delay completes first, then it all stops with an error. Takeo isn't doing anything magic here. If you want to race two futures against each other, you can do that by yourself. The simplest way to do that is with the futures select macro. I'm going to create a demo now of implementing this timeout by creating a second delay future ourselves and then using a select. Okay, first of all, I did a couple more imports. I imported the future extension trait and the select macro. Then, when we received the line, I created a delay future using delay 4, but I didn't await on it immediately. I saved it in this binding called timeout. Next comes the select macro. The way this works is a little bit like a match statement. The first thing I need to do is call fuse on each future. I'm not going to say any more about that right now. It's just something you have to do. One of these two futures is going to complete first. When it does, the resulting value will be placed in this binding on the left. Then it will execute the code block on the right. Our codec future is already returning an option type. This queue will either be some or none. So if the timer triggers, we can just return none, and this will be picked up down here and returned as an error. So let's test out this version. Hopefully, after 5 seconds, the connection will again drop. And it does. So that works equivalently. Obviously, in this case, it's easier and cleaner to use the Tokyo timeout function I showed a minute ago. From time to time, though, situations arise when you have two or more independent futures and you want to make sure they all stop together. This select syntax gives you a much more flexible way to do that, even when one of them isn't a timer. I think that's all I have to say about this IDENT server, so this will be